other choice, and not that Indigenous egg. It's really fascinating to hear more because you always learn new stuff. So, and I feel very privileged to be in a room with these guys. So, unashamedly, I am wearing our hashtag. So feel free to tweet. We have a lot of people around the country who I promised will be lots of tweets coming out today, and we are periscoping it. So, hi guys. So before we start, I just want to introduce myself. This is where I grew up, which is a Wabakal country, which is at Macquarie, which is near Newcastle. Beautiful country. If you hang around with blackfellas long enough, and we talked about this last night, you pretty much find out that the first things they do when they introduce, who's your mum and where you're from? It's kind of what I'm doing with you. So my mum's a Yorta, I'm a Yorta Yorta woman. I grew up on Lake Macquarie though. So Aboriginal is just an umbrella term for those that aren't aware. I didn't know if we were going to have an international audience predominantly or if it was going to be mostly Australians, but just because you're Australian doesn't mean you always know. So this is my family. Now, part of the reason why I put up my family here is because when you read in the media about Aboriginal people, you hear shitloads of negative stuff. And for me, that's really upsetting. This is why I started getting onto Twitter. This is why I started freelancing as a journalist. Because the stories I read in the media only demonstrate a very small proportion of who and what we are. And this is my family. We're happy, we're proud, we're successful. We're not just the things that you see in the media. So my brother on the left is a physio, then there's me, then there's my other brother who's got a double degree, and this is my mum and dad. And you know, so whenever you read the stuff in the media, please think of my family and go, oh, okay, those statistics might be true, but we're not just the sum total of our issues, we're actually a hell of a lot more than that. So just so you know a bit about me, I'm a bit like Luke. I have no idea what profession I do or in. I have a Master of Public Health, I have a Bachelor of Social Science with a major in linguistics. And I'm currently doing a PhD in Aboriginal health, but in NKPI. So I do a range of things, and a freelance as a journalist, and national performance indicators for Aboriginal community-controlled health services. Sorry, I figured I probably should. So that is me. I'm also an ex-drama teacher, which is why I love a stage. I'm up here because of Dr. Mark Wenetong, who couldn't be here and recommended me. And as soon as he said that I would be presenting, I was there. So let me just, before I go any further, talk about the Just Justice team. There is a large number of people that are supporters of Just Justice, but these are the crew who are actually the ones that do most of the hard work behind it. and so these guys can't be here today. I'm luckily enough here, but there's more than just me, and I always like to recognise them. And by the way, all of the stuff that's on in that yellow colour is hyperlinked, because I hear that they're going to put up the presentation.
Right.
So anything and everything that is yellow, which is most of my presentation, is actually hyperlinked, so you can go on and check them out later. So we have a large number of Just Justice supporters. Here are the main ones. Luke is up there. Yep. So most of these mob are Aboriginal, and that's one of the reasons why I was very, very keen to get involved in Just Justice when the initial conversation started. We didn't call it that. And I'll get to what actually Just Justice is. Actually, before I do that, one of the reasons why I put the definition of health up here from an Aboriginal perspective is because people sometimes think that you do health, or you do justice, or you do education. One of the things that's really, really important in Aboriginal health is that it's not just the absence of disease, it's actually all and everything. So even though I have a public health background, the reason I'm involved in this is because over-incarceration of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples destroys our culture, families, communities, and impacts on our health. And for me, everything that does impact on your health is a health issue, and the over-incarceration of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people is most certainly a health issue. So Just Justice, what is it? It was funny when I was putting these slides up, I reordered them a million times and couldn't figure out which one went there, where. But essentially what we're trying to do is raise the issue of the over-incarceration of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples. We're trying to reframe the conversation. A lot of the stuff that you hear in the media, as I said, is the negative stuff. But you're not hearing what's happening on the ground, you're not hearing what the communities are doing. And so through our social media platforms, through the Croaky blog, we're actually telling those other stories that you don't traditionally hear. And so that's a link to Croaky. Croaky's just launched, and if you follow Croaky Doll, they've got it. Sorry, they've launched a new website. My apologies. They've been around for quite some time. So it's Croaky Doll. So it literally started out as some general conversations, and I can't even remember. Melissa Sweet was talking to me about the issue. She'd spoken about it with Tom Cowler, I think, and then Mick Gooder as well. And we ended up just kind of coming together. It was this really organic thing, which is really quite exciting because Melissa's, you know, massive on Twitter, and we just kind of got going. So we are crowdfunded as well, my one and only. I tell you, I'm not sure I'll ever do one again. I don't think I've gotten over the first one. 2 months of hell. Seriously. It is hectic. If someone had told me that I was going to be that exhausted after doing a crowdfunding campaign, I'm not sure I would have gotten involved. So, but we had support with Luke and other people, and everyone came together, and we ended up raising $30,000. But we had 3 days to go and needed $10,000. And if it wasn't for the power of social media and the connections that we have within the Twitter world, I don't think we would have made it. We had a lot of really fantastic support out there, and I think it's because, you know, so many people see the value in this. And one of the things that really impressed me about the crowdfunding campaign and about how we got funded with Just Justice was the very fact that we only had one organisation who supported us, that was the Jesuit Social Services. We had one very large single donor, but other than that, it was individual Australians who actually saw that this was an issue and donated. And we ended up with $30,000, which I have to say, I was very, very privileged to be part of that and very thankful that people felt that this was an issue and this is something that needed to be done. And it really gave us the confidence that we were going down the right track. So that was really reassuring. So just to put it in context, I thought I'd better tell you about some of the actual issues. So for example, it's $120,000 to keep an adult in prison. And in my mind, I think if we invested that money in diversionary programs, we wouldn't need as many prisons. When you've got 28% of the population that is in jail is Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander, and we only make up 3% of the population, there's something wrong. 50% of juveniles that are incarcerated are Aboriginal. To me, that just breaks my heart. I don't want to see our kids in jail, and I want to see programs, that money invested in programs to support our kids. I was really lucky. I had a really privileged upbringing as an Aboriginal woman, and I want to make sure that all of our kids have the same opportunities I had, and unfortunately not all of them do, and those that do fall between the cracks, they shouldn't end up in juvenile justice. It's not going to do them any good. And the range of people that are actually identified as Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander are in jail range from 8% to 86%. You've got 0.6 of the population in Victoria is Aboriginal, and they make up 8%. In the Northern Territory, for example, they make up about 30% and they're 86% of the population. So this is what we're doing, and this is why we're raising this. And this is why we're talking about Aboriginal solutions. And I should say Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander. As an Aboriginal woman, I sometimes forget that there's Torres Strait Islanders. My apologies. And you know, the other thing is, if you're 74% more likely to be reconvicted if you're given a jail sentence, which tells me if we invested again in those diversionary programs, people are less likely to be reconvicted. So just put it into perspective internationally, you've got similar stats all around the world. So this is not just a problem with Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people, unfortunately. And I think it goes back to colonisation, the impacts of colonisation, which I wanted to talk about the contributing factors. And so these are the kind of things and the messages that we want to get out as well, is that it's not just do the crime, do the time. Like, there are a whole range of factors and contributing factors that we need to look at and address rather than taking a superficial approach. And again, we've got amazing people like Darren Parker, who's an Aboriginal man, and he's a lawyer, who's actually written a story for us. He's written two, actually. One of them was about his own personal experiences of family violence, and it's the first time he shared them publicly because he felt that this was an important cause. And then the next one is, as a lawyer, as a constitutional lawyer, he was actually looking at some of the discriminatory policies and sharing them with us so we could share them with other people. And these are things that often don't get heard as much. Like, as black fellas, we talk about this shit all the time. But it never seems to get out in the public space. And that's one of the things that I'm really grateful to Melissa Sweet and croaking for is for giving us a space where, and encouraging a space where we can actually then put these issues and stories into the public. So, social media platforms, you guys all know them. So we decided it wasn't just going to be one, it was obviously going to be all of them, because different ones attract different people. And one of the things you'll find, particularly with Aboriginal people, is, you know, I'm a Koori, so we call it the Koori grapevine, but this is why I think we're taken to social media so well, is because we like to yarn. And it's funny, I can have a new boyfriend and my auntie in Victoria knows the next day, and it's somehow the Koori grapevine gets through. So if we can actually target all of the platforms, we'll have a much wider reach courtesy of the blackfellas, which is fantastic. So I wanted to play a quick video. Now, you hear me talking again briefly, but it's really just to hear from Mick Gooder. So, as I said, Mick Gooder is a supporter. He is fantastic. He's the Social Justice Commissioner, and I have to say, I don't think that we would have been able to get this on the ground without him. And to be honest with you, I wasn't going to participate in Just Justice as the only Aboriginal person if we didn't have some other key Aboriginal people supporting us, because I needed to know from my community that this was something that they wanted to see, that the message was the right, and also that it was the right time as well. So here's a little video.
I'm Summer Mae Finlay from the Just Justice team. According to Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Social Justice Commissioner Mick Gooder, over-incarceration is a critically important issue for the health of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples, families and communities.
I'll point this issue around incarceration one of the most important areas for me in my last two years, because I think it's a catastrophe waiting. You know, it's not waiting to happen, it's happening, but the impacts will be felt downstream from what we're seeing today. Whatever we can do to put this issue in front and centre of people's minds, I think we've got to do. That's why I think what they're doing in Crowley is a really, really important step in that process.
It would be fantastic if people could donate. Anything helps, everything helps. The more donations we get, the more we can actually support communities to tell their stories.
Tom likes to talk as well. This is Tom and Alma. So that one went for half an hour. So that was a Periscope. The second one was a Periscope. We did with Tom. And he was in love with Periscope after that. He got 339 viewers. And he's like, internationally. And you could see his mind was ticking over. I just wanted to show you that. So that's the film we actually put up. It's not Flash, not like the Deadly Choices one. We kind of did it in Melissa Sweet's backyard. Melissa Sweet's husband is a graphic designer, a web developer, and does film. But we had a really short turnaround, and at this stage we had zero money. Not that we have a lot of money now. And one of the things that we're doing with most of the money that we're getting, 40% of it, is actually going to community members so we can share their stories. Because like Luke said, a lot of the times people expect us to do things for the love of community, and we actually have to eat too. So we want to make sure that as blackfellas, when we're actually asking other blackfellas to share their stories, that we're giving them a small amount of money. And it is only small, because $30,000 every year doesn't stretch that far. And we want to tell lots of stories. So this was the Just Justice tweet. So this was the people that supported us during the campaign. And again, they're just ordinary people wanting to share their story. And that's one of the things that I love about Twitter is, you know, I've had academics, because they're really sometimes a bit skeptical of anything they don't know, and there's very little evidence to support the reach, blah, blah, blah. Say that Twitter is an echo chamber. And I find quite the opposite. I find Twitter is a really good opportunity to share thoughts with other people, get support for the things, find out that there are actually other people out there who are doing similar stuff to you, connect to new people. I met Luke through Twitter. I don't think I've met you before. I was on Indigenous X, was I? So I've only been on Twitter for 2 years. I went to the NACHO Health Summit. So NACHO is the National Aboriginal Community Controlled Health Organisation. I was there. I'd been on Twitter for a month. There was a bit of a competition to see who could get the most retweets and the most reach. So of course I decided to join in. And then I got asked to do Indigenous X because the person unfortunately had to drop out the day before. So it was baptism by fire for me with Twitter, and I was one of those skeptics. I really did not like Twitter. I could not stand Twitter. I thought it was all consuming. I thought the more you feed the beast, the more it's actually going to give you, and then the more you've got to feed it. I didn't see the value in it. And it wasn't until I got on it and saw Indigenous X that I actually saw the value in it. And now you can't get me off it, as you can see when I was up there. So again, I just wanted to show this as the reach. And again, a lot of people do, you know, you can do the Google Analytics, you can do all that, but it's just looking at these faces that tells me we're making an impact, that we're reaching people. And I've made friends all around the country. I actually have people come, I think I follow you on Twitter. And you're like, oh, okay, thanks. So again, you know, this is again how we've judged how well we're going, and we watch, you know, the numbers creep up. It's actually quite exciting. I get a bit of a buzz out of it. And so I just want to show one of the memes. This is our one and only meme, and I really had to put it up there. So Nigel Scully, a little while ago, came out and said that you can make alcohol out of Vegemite. My issue is not whether you can or whether you can't. My issue is, should it have gotten as much national and international media as it bloody well did when we have disgusting statistics like that? So we decided, not me. I got really angry about it. Someone else thought it was, you know, something we could turn into a humorous but serious comment. And this is our one and only meme, and I thought it was fantastic. And I was really quite upset, so thinking, are they going to come and arrest me now for having Vegemite in my house? sometimes, like, we have a lot of stories, and we promote them on Twitter and Facebook and on the blog. So we have, I think, 20 that we've done between April this year to now. So I've hyperlinked them there for all you people that might want to read every single one of them, if you're super keen, or just the ones that interest you. We just had one up this morning or last night, I can't remember, by Andrew Jackmoss. He's the Children's Commissioner in Victoria. And there seems to be a link, for example, between removing children and juvenile justice. So, I mean, we're looking at all of the impacts and having different people tell their stories. And he'll go through there, and a lot of them are Aboriginal people that are telling stories, which is fantastic. And as Luke said, most of the ones we're actually had at the moment are professional, career-driven people who do this stuff for a living. Darren the lawyer, you know, Andrew Backler, Andrew Jackmoss. And so, you know, it's really important to recognise, and this is one of the things, recognising that Aboriginal people have a space within our own affairs. I often find that as an Aboriginal woman, particularly a younger Aboriginal woman, we seem to not be taken seriously in our own space because we have a vested interest. And if you have a vested interest and you can't be objective, then you clearly, your opinions aren't valued. And we wanted to actually show that even though you have a vested interest, you can have a skill set and a knowledge, and we value that. So I'm just going to flick through all of our articles because I'm so impressed with it. But once I put these slides together, did I realise how much we'd actually done. So again, we're using Twitter a lot. We've done some Twitter sessions with Mark Locke, who's an academic. He did that when he was on Indigenous X. We've done Twitter interviews. I did one about Just Justice with We Public Health, who was hosted by, I can't remember her name from last week, Yvonne
Luxford.
Luxford, yes. And we also did, I was also involved and also was one of the facilitators for a session on IHMA Day, which is Indigenous Health May Day, which is the second one we did last year. So we're really trying to take Twitter over, I think, which is fantastic. So, you know, what are we hoping to achieve through all this? We're using social media, you know, blogging, Periscope, Twitter, Facebook. We really just want to actually share it and promote Aboriginal voices and Aboriginal perspectives because they often get lost in the mainstream. People talk about us. Occasionally they'll talk to us, but we very rarely get a voice unless you're one of the lucky media darlings who I'm sure if you're Australian you know who I'm referring to. You know, there are a lot of other people in the space, there are a lot of Aboriginal voices, there are a lot of different views as well, and similarly to Indigenous X, we are, and also Deadly Choices, we're apolitical. If you're Labor, Liberal, Greens, we're happy to hear from you, as long as you're promoting positive stories, as long as you're talking solutions. You can talk issues, as long as you're coupling that with solutions that don't just involve jail, we are more than happy to hear from you. And we really, really support alternative views and conversations, because there's not one solution, there's not one issue, there's not just, you know, to this issue. And I guess for me, as someone who's worked in health and someone that's worked in public health, I see this as a public health campaign, a public health promotion. A lot of people think public health is often just what you do on the ground with communities, and they forget that that kind of advocacy stuff at the high level, at that kind of national or international level, is actually public health too. So I really see this as a public health campaign through social media, and I feel very lucky to be involved. So here are our very generous supporters, who I wouldn't actually be able to stand here and tell you about this without them. So Generous Social Services is the one and only organisation that donated to us, and we are very, very grateful to them. And also, One Vision, who brought all our AVs to you today, is actually Frank Meaney, who runs One Vision. He actually donated as an individual, but is happy for us to promote his company as well. And so I just wanted to put them on as well. And then there's the contact details. So that is me. Thank you.
Thank you.